Well, good morning, everybody. I'm absolutely thrilled to be here and delighted to have been invited. Thank you. I'd like to tell you about a quest that I've been on. A quest over the last 20 years of my research career. And the quest is to understand how all these fascinating, vigorous, community-led movements for sustainability. We've heard about so many of them here at this conference. There are so many in Leeds. You've got Lilac, for instance. You've got the food groups at the university and countless others. We know that they're doing great work. And isn't it frustrating that they're so small and marginal? Don't you want them to get big and start to have real impact, real influence on society? Well, I do. So I've been on a quest to understand how we can unleash these grassroots innovations for sustainability. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about the work that we've been doing along that way. So traditionally, the kind of studies that you get on these sorts of projects conclude that yes, these groups are doing excellent well, aren't they marvellous? What they really need to do is scale up, and to do that they need policy support and they need some funding. And that's usually the last paragraph of most evaluation reports of these kinds of projects. But the thing is, even in the late 90s, in the golden age of support for community activities, and certainly now with the Cameron Big Society aid, when there's all the rhetoric but less funding, you know, there was this push for community activity, for quality of life and well-being. But still, these projects, they didn't grow, they didn't get massively mainstream, they still stayed pretty marginal. And I began to wonder, is there something else going on? Is it actually more than just we need policy support and funding? Is there something intrinsic to these kind of projects, which is stopping them growing, and actually maybe that's the thing we need to be paying attention to get them over this next step? To be honest, part of the problem, I think, is what I call the Margot and Jerry problem. I apologise if this means nothing to you. But it's all very well having groups of committed activists doing really quite radical stuff. They're inspirational, they are motivational, they get things going, you know, there's no holding them back. But there'll only ever be a small proportion of society. There's no good expecting Margot and Jerry to start living like Tom and Barbara. They're not going to ever. So what we need to do is to come up with solutions that Margot and Jerry, the normal people, are going to be happy to take up and engage with. So for me, that was a large part of the problem, really. How can we solve the Margot and Jerry problem, get hundreds of thousands of millions of normal people involved in these kinds of initiatives which are currently only being pioneered by handfuls or hundreds? So 10 years ago, I organised a conference with Adrian Smith from Sussex University on grassroots innovations. We wanted to tackle exactly this problem. And this is our definition of grassroots innovations. We wanted to see these radical community initiatives, not just as community development, not just as green politics or activism. We wanted to actually start to look at them as innovations and learn from what innovation theory can tell us about how to grow and diffuse these activities into wider society. Now, I saw this slide on the presentation yesterday, so I know I'm not the only person here who's searching for the Holy Grail. But the Holy Grail I'm interested in is, how can we help these innovations to diffuse into wider society? How can we help them to grow, spread, have more influence through a range of different means? And the theory that we looked to is known as the sustainability transitions theory. It's a co-evolutionary approach to understanding how societies might change. It looks at systems rather than individuals, and it says that society and technology co-evolve together. They don't happen in isolation from each other. So this was a very good approach to take for our community-led innovations, which are as much about social change, social innovation, as they are about technologies. So this was the body of theory that we looked to. And this theory says that radical innovation happens in niches, which exist in opposition to mainstream systems. And if niches can develop and get really effective, then they've got a good chance of disrupting or influencing the mainstream system. And we thought, yes, great, that's exactly what we want to find out. What can this theory tell us? So this is what I'm going to tell you a little bit about today. Of course, most of this theory looks at market innovations and technologies. We're applying it to civil society and institutional infrastructural innovation. So we weren't sure how well the theory would fit. This is one of the things we're investigating. But we thought it could have some insights for us. The empirical case that we've applied it to, that I'm telling you about today, is community currencies. A lot of these illustrations now are of different types of community currencies which have been set up around the world. So I'll tell you more about those in a minute. But just going back to diffusion, we defined three different ways that innovations could diffuse. First of all, they can replicate. In other words, you can have small community projects and they can spread the word and we can have lots more small community projects. That's one way of getting more people engaged and participating. Another way is by getting your small projects and growing them up to be big projects. That's scaling up. And then the third route is translation, which is where elements of your radical innovation get adopted and taken up by the mainstream system. And a good example of that would be organic food. Now, organic food was originally part of a radical social movement. But now, the technological aspect of organic food has become incorporated into the mainstream food system. So that's an example of translation, where elements of the idea get adopted. So before we go any further, I'll just explain to you what this theory thinks is a niche. This is where radical innovations are experimented with, and hopefully they develop and they get standardised and they get consolidated to a point where they're able to have influence. So a niche is more than projects. You have lots of radical projects on the ground of a certain type. The niche is the sort of level above them. It's the networks, it's the intermediaries, it's the conferences, it's the newsletters, it's the people who are able to go and talk to policymakers on behalf of the local projects. So a niche is about the stuff that's going on above the level of local projects, which works to develop the sector. The niche normally is informed by the local projects to begin with, where projects think, oh, we need a network to help us share learning and so on, publicise ourselves. And over time, the theory says the niche will actually start to standardise the design of the innovation by learning from best practice and then going on to inform the new projects that set up. The theory says that over time we get this big experimentation that's narrowed down to something which is really quite effective, transferable, and can have impact. So we wanted to test how well this works. The other thing to mention from the theory is that strategic niche management is one approach that we use. It says that niches have to do three things very well in order to be effective. They have to share learning and best practice, so that it's easier for other projects to set up and learn from experience. They need to do effective networking to support projects, but also to bring in resources from other actors in society to support the sector. They need to develop coherent visions and expectations about what it is they're for and what they're going to deliver. And those visions have to be realistic so that people aren't disappointed. And then in the context that they're in, there needs to be an opportunity for this niche to start to provide some lessons to the system. So the mainstream system has to be in crisis of some sort and looking for new answers. Because really the mainstream system isn't interested in radical innovations unless it's got a problem to solve. So complementary currencies, I know that many of you here are familiar with this term. They're basically parallel systems of exchange which run alongside ordinary money. They meet social and environmental and economic needs that mainstream money doesn't meet. And there are many thousands of them around the world, all different types. Now we're used to concepts like net to points and air miles and so on. We're used to using complementary currencies all the time. We earn them, we save them, we store them, we spend them on something else. So really this is just something different. This is something similar kinds of parallel mechanisms of exchange designed to meet sustainability objectives. What's great about bringing this talk to this conference is that many of these initiatives were inspired by ecological economics critiques of the money system. So going back into the 1970s and 80s, the Green Movement and so on, green economists, ecological economists, realised that our current money system which is created by debt and therefore forces us to grow the economy in order to earn the interest to pay back the debt, our current money system locks us into a growth-based economy. So money is not a neutral tool which just facilitates exchange. Money structures the kind of economy that we have. Now, community currencies for sustainability, there are lots of different types, but generally they don't, they're not debt-based and they don't charge interest. Therefore, they are the kind of money you could have if you wanted a steady-state economy. So that's why we might be interested in these kinds of initiatives. They have rather broader sustainability goals as well. On the economic side, they can be designed to promote local economic transactions if you have a currency that only circulates in a local area. They can also be used to reward the kinds of core economy work that Cecilia was talking about, the work which doesn't attract value in the mainstream economy. We can reward people for volunteering and for supporting their neighbours in other kinds of currencies. These currencies are also very good at building social capital and so on. And on the environmental side, again, promoting localization is held up as an environmental objective. They can also be used to specifically facilitate sharing relationships, and also there are some kind of smart card-based ones, which literally just reward you for making more sustainable purchases when you go to the shops. So there's a whole range of different kinds of projects with different kinds of objectives under this broad heading. Now, there are four main types in the world. Local exchange trading schemes, LETs, is probably the most commonly known in the UK. Service credits, time banks, time dollars in the US is another type. Everybody's time is valued equally. You know, slightly different focus in what they're about than the LET schemes. You've got local currencies. Strangely enough, in the UK, this is our newest wave of community currencies. Which are very much about promoting local economic development. And then barter markets, which are very marginal in terms of the world population of currencies. But you may have heard of the Argentinian barter markets at the end of the 1990s in the financial crash. These went from being small green economic projects to suddenly becoming an absolute lifeline for millions of people when their economy collapsed. The barter market system itself collapsed pretty soon after that. But the newer ones that are coming up are sort of like glorified car boot fairs, where you go and circulate stuff that you don't want anymore, using a currency just for that particular event. So these newer ones have got a bit more of a kind of free cycling type ethos to them. So those are the four main types around the world. And we can see that they fit the definition of grassroots innovations very well. Obviously, the ones we're looking at are not coming from corporations, they're coming from civil society. They're very value-driven. Ideology is often the main thing that they're motivated by. They're interested in creating new infrastructures. As Sigrid said, this is absolutely critical. We need new infrastructures, we need collective solutions that go beyond behaviour change. We need new systems of provision. Well, this is creating a new system of provision of money and exchange and finance, which is designed to deliver sustainability. So for a worldwide study of community currencies, we were looking at currency niches. So we were looking at countries where you had five or more projects of a certain type within a certain country. We called that a currency niche. There were many, many other currencies which there weren't enough of to constitute a niche. But we were just looking for niches because this is what we wanted to understand. So we found almost 40 niches around the world, mainly in Europe, mainly of the LEX and time banks varieties. And what was interesting was that after 25 years or so of community currencies being on the scene, we definitely were not seeing the standardisation that niche theory said we should have been seeing. We were seeing increasing diversification, increasing forms of hybrid forms of currency being set up. With new information technologies, the possibilities were endless. So first thing was we weren't seeing what the theory predicted. What was interesting was that a lot of these currencies have been spread through green movements, particularly the New Economics Foundation has been pivotal in the UK at getting these currencies introduced and spread around. What was interesting in terms of how movements spread around the world, how innovation spread, was that language really mattered. many, many, many years, and literally the rest of the world doesn't know about it because nobody's had the resources to sit down and do the translation work and make information available in other languages. It's extraordinary. What we also found was that English-speaking countries had one trajectory of community currency development, and French and Spanish-speaking countries had another, and they were kind of in parallel to each other as well. So how do innovations diffuse? Well, word of mouth matters, it depends what language you're speaking. But the other thing we found was, remember these three diffusion routes? Replication was the main one, and this is related to the word of mouth thing. People would read something in a newspaper, go to an event, hear an inspirational speaker, and they would go back to their hometown and set one of these projects up. So word of mouth, replication, bottom-up activism was the main thing we'd see. But remember, that hasn't got us very far, and we wanted the answers to how we can get up to the next level, really. So doing a kind of niche analysis, we found that at the international level, globally, you've got magazines, global conferences, an academic journal. You've got people who travel the world spreading the word. Influential people, you've got all kinds of databases. Now these cover all different currency types. So really diverse visions represented at this level. And they're pretty much all done by volunteers. But this is where the main international sharing goes on. And then at the country level, within a particular type, so for example, time banks in the UK, you've got a single currency, a single vision, much more coherent. You've got national networks, you've got some policy support, you've got evaluations and learning going on, you've got more funding probably, and you've got all the relationships to the local projects. But actually not very well connected to the international niche level. So there's some real gaps going on. In terms of getting our niche activities together. So that was the first thing we found. But really, you know, the holy grail that we came here for was to find out what really matters. What's going to unlock these innovations? What are the keys to success? So we looked at 12 of our different currency niches. We looked at different currency types, different countries, older ones and newer ones, to try and get the biggest spread. And we did lots of interviews and so on, and then we scored them. We gave them a score for how much niche activity they were doing. So in terms of networking, lobbying, have they got a good website, do they make newsletters, do they provide training, this kind of niche building. And then we gave them other scores for how successful they've been at diffusing along each of those three diffusion routes. And the big headline is that the two figures correlate. So niche activity relates to diffusion success. But, you know, we wanted to go into it a little bit more than that. And we wanted to find out, actually, which factors matter the most. So, what we found, and perhaps this isn't surprising, is that if you have a proactive policy environment, you will get 35% more diffusion. But you'll also get 35%, these figures are kind of crazy, really, but I quite like them. 35% more niche activities going on. So an encouraging policy context gives you more of this networking, intermediary type stuff, which in turn leads to more diffusion success. So a positive policy environment is absolutely critical. The currencies are quite low tech, easy to replicate. Someone can read about it in a magazine and go and set one up themselves the next week. They spread like wildfire. That's not very surprising. And related to that, project-to-project support and networking was the most influential factor in how successful a currency had been at diffusing, spreading, growing. If a currency can be applied to a whole range of different regimes or sectors, then that really helps with translation. So for instance, you've got the Bristol Pound, which wants to be a local currency. That's really only related to the financial sector. But you've got time banks or spice credits and so on. They can relate to education, school, transport, health, all kinds of things. So they're a solution that can be picked up by a whole range of different sectors and adapted more easily. So they're more successful at translating into mainstream systems. So very quickly, these were the top things that mattered for each of our three diffusion groups. What was interesting was that niche activity
which the theory predicts is really vital, actually didn't matter very much for replication or for scaling up. For scaling up, what was interesting was that most of our niches had one big project and then lots of little ones. And the other ones we couldn't get as big as the big one. So that suggested there was something in the context, or maybe, you know, the old chestnut charismatic leaders and so on. It can actually be quite difficult to replicate big scaled up projects. If your context is about a kind of bohemian culture where people are happy to try new green stuff, or a place like in Germany, some areas of Germany, they have lots of local pride and they love their local currency because it represents their local area. If you have an enabling context, that really helps to get the project big. But that's not so easy to replicate. So we have seen diffusion, obviously, and we had slightly confirmed the theory, but there's quite a few things missing from the theory. There was so little systematic learning. It was boggling that anybody had ever done anything. Or at least they kept reinventing the wheel. You know, systematic learning and sharing best practice was a huge gap. There was, again, as I said, no standardisation really going on, more and more experimentation, which is what you get from bottom-up stuff. But maybe that's not conducive to actually streamlining an innovation, starting to aim higher. You got real tensions in this thing about having coherent, realistic visions between radical activists who want to do away with the money system and be completely autonomous, and the people who want to create a system which is complementary to the money system, and want to go and talk to policymakers and the NHS and the education authority about how to work together. So you have got, as with any activist movement, of course, you've got this tension. And we found that rather than our diffusion trajectory being like that, which is what theory says, you know, some went like that, some went like that, some were plateauing, they were all over the place. So there's something about our something about these cases which doesn't fit the theory. But despite not doing all this, you know, the diffusion was still happening. And we put this down to the inherent characteristics of these innovations, which is where we started from. So grassroots innovations have distinctive resource bases. They have loads of volunteers with loads of passionate energy, but they don't have much money. That leads them to do certain kinds of things in certain kinds of ways, which is good, but it closes off other opportunities. They represent a massive proliferation of different experiments, values, and objectives, which again is good and leads to limitations later on. Above all, we've got these three tensions to deal with. On the one hand, you've got currencies run in a top-down way, where you've got NGOs organising them. They have a nice standardised vision, but they take a lot of resources and they're quite slow to multiply. Versus the bottom-up, which spread like wildfire, but then they kind of hit a block and don't go any further. So you've got this tension here. You've got the tension between simple stuff to set up, which is maybe not very convenient to use, and so not many people are going to use it, versus the stuff which fits into our lives seamlessly, like smart card, local currency payments, and so on. Margot and Jerry might like that, actually. But they're more expensive to set up, a lot more involved, and so on. And finally, you've got this tension about whether or not we engage with the mainstream economy. So, the Holy Grail, have we found it? I think we're getting a little bit closer. We can have more nuanced messages. Yes, we need policy support, yes, we need funding. But let's target it in the right places. It's the intermediary level, not the projects, which are critical to growing these movements. So we need to be supporting the networks and the shared learning and that kind of thing. We saw we had misaligned niche activities between different levels. They need to get in sync and the right activities need to be happening at the right level to grow these innovations. And of course, there will always be some people who want to run these projects purely autonomously, and they're not interested in mainstreaming. They don't want Margot and Jerry involved. And that's fine. But others do. So there's this tension between the two that needs to be managed quite sensitively. Now, my hope, my belief, is that by doing this kind of work, gaining these kind of insights, we can really help to unleash the transformative potential of grassroots innovations and inform practitioners, policymakers, and even sustainability transitions theorists about how we could take this forward. Thank you for your attention.